Yes, a very good morning to you. Thanks so very much, you know, for joining us once again. My name is Henry Sekanjako, welcoming you to another segment of Urban Today. And of course, so we are going to be talking about the World News Day. We're looking at media and the COVID-19. What role does the media, you know, play in this fight against this pandemic? And of course, today being, you know, the World News Day, of course, we've been joined by Susan Juliet Agwang. Of course, she's the legal and research officer at the Africa Freedom of Information Center. And she's going to be, you know, helping us understand what role the media has played and what does the World News Day mean to her. Susan, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much, Henry.
Beautiful. Mm-hmm. Okay, today we are celebrating the World News Day. What does this mean to you?
You know, it's quite really exciting that News Day is also the Universal Day of Access to Information, which was adopted by the UN General Assembly in October last year. So it's really very, because you cannot have news when you don't have information. Sure. So for us, it's like that grand achievement as civil society, as government, as citizens, that, you know, at the end of it all, we have eventually got this one day recognized. And not just recognized now, it's been recognized before, but only that, you know, we had not come out very vibrantly and set out a day to remember that access to information and news is a very significant thing.
Sure. Mm-hmm. And, you know, talking about of access to information, how do you rate that, you know, vis-a-vis the, you know, the COVID, you know, situation that we have been in as Ugandans, have we, you know, had that, you know, good access to information as we require?
Well, as maybe before we narrow it down to the Ugandan, whether we have access to information, first of all, we need to applaud the government for taking one bold step at enacting an access to information law. If you may realize that Uganda was the first country in East Africa to enact an access to information law, and the fifth country in Africa to enact an access to information law. And that is a tremendous step, because we cannot start talking about implementation when we don't have something on the table yet. So really, we applaud the government for that step, and other countries as well that have these laws, because right now in Africa, there are 25 countries with access to information laws out of the 55 AU states.
That's true.
And the latest addition on the block has been Ghana, which also goes into implementation. Today is the day when they officially start implementation of the access to information law. But of course, studies have shown in the past, not just our own studies as an institution, Africa Freedom of Information Center, we have had studies done by the UN themselves. Now, the UNESCO is the body charged, it's the custodian of the indicator on access to information, which is Sustainable Development Goal 16-10-2. So they usually do annual studies to see where are we moving towards realizing the Sustainable Development Goals. Mm-hmm. And the 2019 findings showed that despite existence of access to information laws in the world, we are still challenged with implementation. And more specifically, speaking to Africa, they said that, you know, we need to realize that adopting a law is not enough. We need to have it implemented. So today as well, UNESCO will be launching global findings, and Africa will be among the continents where they're going to release findings that where are we from 5 years ago, 1 year ago? Where are we in terms of realizing access to information implementation?
Yes. Talking about access to information, how would you rate, you know, Uganda?
I would say we are 50-50. I don't want to say that we are also doing very bad, because we have tried. But then it's not enough to say, since we have given you the law, we have played our part. Government's role is a continuous one, to the point that the last person on the ground appreciates that, you know, I know it, I can engage my government. You know, our constitution recognizes access to information under Article 41. Yeah. But most importantly, Article 38 tells us that, you know, every citizen has a right to participate in affairs of the state. Yeah. You know, that is a huge opportunity for a citizen to participate. Yeah. And because government cannot work alone, it cannot operate alone, it needs someone. You need a person, a honest person, to tell you, hey, I think you have a hair on your face, we need to remove it. Or if you're looking good, someone to tell you, you know, you're doing it right, keep it up. Okay. So that is why we need the citizen under Article 38, that, you know, how are we doing? We need to check if there is a problem. So really, we are challenged with implementation, because we've not done only one study or two. We have been doing studies every year, and our latest assessment, which has been the shadow report, which we presented to the Parliament of Uganda last year,
yeah.
that our assessment found that we are still challenged in terms of implementation, most especially when it comes to annual reporting to Parliament, because the law provides that every year, every ministry should submit an annual report to Parliament, telling it, you know, this is the status where we are, these are the challenges that we are facing, among others.
That's
but
true.
Unfortunately, mm-hmm. even with an information request that we made to Parliament, no ministry has ever submitted an annual report.
Mm-hmm.
So that clearly shows you that we are not following the law, okay? We need to go back to the drawing board and then start doing these things.
Yeah.
Yes.
You talked about, when I asked you about how you'd rate Uganda, you said 50-50.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the challenges, the hindrances that, you know, barring Ugandans from accessing certain information. Of course, as a journalist, we have approached quite a number of government, you know, departments,
mm-hmm.
offices, and you would ask, you know, for some information, and then they would say it's confidential. As you know, according to you, as you know, Africa Freedom, you know, Africa Freedom of Information Center,
mm-hmm.
What do you think are some of the hindrances that, you know, bar Ugandans from accessing certain information? Because if you, you know, get nice some bit of information, you need to have access to information.
Okay, thank you very much. That's quite a brilliant one. Okay, now, like I said previously, there is having the law, and then we're not seeing it, feeling it being implemented. But there have to be reasons for that. And some of the reasons that our assessments have shown is there's lack of awareness.
Mm.
Lack of awareness, not just for you and me, but up to the government level. Yeah, you may find that the accounting officers, which the law recognizes as chief executives of the institution. So if we come to New Vision, for example, the chief executive officer is the information officer. They may be aware about this, you know, this right about the law and all that. But when you go down to specific persons, if I walked and asked a procurement officer, I need to access this information, most likely they're going to say, no, this is confidential information.
Yeah.
And you know, someone confidently says it because they do not know it. So imagine if they knew, they would definitely say, okay, this and that and that. And I must tell you that there are institutions that we've gone to, and because the person is aware and then we ask them, you get a response even in 2 days, despite
mm-hmm.
the fact that the law says within 21 days. You may get this information even instantly. So during our awareness raising, because we, after assessing that the challenge that we have is lack of awareness, we decided to, let's start training them. Let's start training the public officials. Let's start training civil society. Let's train the media and let's train the citizen, okay? And during that time is when we realized all these challenges. But if we did a base, not really a baseline, an end line right now, because we've done a baseline before, you would see that there's a difference.
Mm-hmm.
We have had citizens use the access to information law. I'll give you an example. In NEBI, for example, so there was a World Bank funded project. And we had trained the civil society actors and the citizens that, you know, you have a right to access this information, make an information request. It doesn't have to be very formal. Sometimes even just walk there and ask it. Go to the notice board, see it. And if you don't see it, you can follow up and ask for it. And then somebody went to the district. And unfortunately, the cow was not aware that actually this challenge was happening down at the local levels, because districts are very vast.
Mm.
So then he was entertained to, you know, give an audience by the CAO. And then this led to, the issue came up to the World Bank, up to the point that World Bank had to go and assess their own project, that how come what we were funding actually did not happen. It also happened in another district that one of the women that we trained went to the hospital and asked for a record of the medicine that had been supplied. You know, this is a great step.
Yep.
And when she did that, of course, definitely they had to ask her, you know, why do you want this information and all that? But then she said, I just want to know about it because I know my right to information. So you see, it really puts you on the on at gunpoint as a public official that, you know, people know.
Mm.
And then you also need to know.
Beautiful.
Yes.
All right, you're still watching Urban TV and it's Urban Today. In the studio is Susan Juliet Aguang, because she's the legal and research officer at the Africa Freedom of Information Center. And we're talking about the World News Day. Of course, you can join the conversation on Urban Television, that's on Facebook, at Urban TV Uganda on Twitter. Seka Henry, Facebook, Seka Henry on Twitter, Lynn Combi Shayuji3 on Twitter, and Lynn Combi on Facebook, and share you know your thoughts on what you think about this. And of course, I would like, want to thank you for those that are watching, in retail watching in from Bukoto. Thanks so very much for tuning in. And of course, Susan, I wanted to speak to you about, of course, the media plays a big role in dissemination mm-hmm. of information in Uganda mm-hmm. and across the world. What do you think are some of the challenges as civil society have come to note that are, you know, preventing the media from disseminating this kind of information?
Thank you so much, Henry. Now, the key thing, and this was told to us by the media themselves on Friday. So we had a press conference on Friday, setting the pace, setting the stage, raising the banner to commemorating the 28th, which is the Access to Information Day today. And I remember two of the journalists asked us a question that, what do you think? How do you rate the government in terms of respecting the rights of the media? Mm-hmm. And then he went ahead and said, you know, the challenge that we are facing is that we are looked at as enemies of the state, mm-hmm. which is very unfortunate.
That comes out a lot.
That mm-hmm. is very unfortunate. Mm-hmm. But I want to tell everyone that, especially during COVID-19, if we never had the media, we would be dead the times that we have right now.
Sure.
Yes. Mm-hmm. The state itself has been challenged in so many ways, including economic-wise, in terms of, you know, we want to push out this information. But to push out the information, you need someone who is giving it to you for free. And who is there to give it for free? You are there, I am there, and every other media person is out there. They simply need the information. Because at the end of the day as well, we do not want the wrong information to get out. You know, we have a pandemic, but we also have an infodemic. That if we don't give out timely and accurate information, we're definitely going to have misinformation. And when we have misinformation, we're going to have a bad eye pointing to the government, bad fingers pointing and saying, you never did this, you never did that, when actually you could have done that, or you could have mitigated it by giving this information. So really, we invite the government actors, public institutions, as well as private actors, that, you know, we cannot do this without the media. It's impossible. We cannot bring out this information. How many times do government actors call the media for press conferences? Imagine the media sat back and said, you know, we're not going for these press conferences. Mm-hmm. Your message will never get out because the media runs the media houses. The media houses cannot run if there is no journalist to pick the message and take it there. Yeah. So we need to accept the fact that the media, the journalists, are a critical aspect on realization of access to information. But also, most importantly, that we need to sit, or even we are past sitting down, we need to agree. Probably the only thing that we need to check right now is access to information is not an absolute right, and neither is freedom of expression. Yeah, we only have a very few outright rights, whereby there is no limitation, but these ones have slight limitations, and those slight limitations have been recognized by the African Charter on Human and People's Rights. It's been recognized by the greatest document in the world, which is the Universal Declaration on Human Rights, and also the most binding document, the treaty, which is the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. And these documents say access to information may be limited only, mark me, only in justifiable circumstances, and those circumstances must be stipulated in the law. For example, if I want to access your private information, and by private I mean I want to know your HIV status, that is private information, because we also have international instruments recognizing right to privacy. So really, we need to strike the balance, and that balance must be recognized under the law. Like, our own law stipulates what is exempted, but it still goes ahead and says that despite exemptions, access to information will override the exemptions as long as there is fundamental public interest. So despite your HIV status, which is private, if it is something of fundamental public interest, we can still get that information relying on the same laws.
All right, we seem to be running out of time, Susan. But before, you know, we conclude on this particular topic, I wanted us to talk about media and COVID. How would you rate the Ugandan media, you know, in terms of disseminating information that concerning COVID?
A few months ago, that was around May, we celebrated the World Press Freedom Day. And what was very outstanding for me during World Press Freedom Day was COVID-19. The media is becoming very vulnerable to it. We have had so many great, I will say the most advanced media groups in the world, testing for COVID-19. We have seen Richard Quest of CNN testing positive for COVID-19. So I want you to imagine, these are established persons, they have great technology. You would imagine that they would not get the disease. Yeah. But because they want to get information, they are at the front line of fighting this disease. They will risk it for everything. And that is the beauty about the media, that even if there was war right now, you will still find a media person trying to capture. There is a fire, but the media person wants to capture it and enter the building and give you the accurate information as it comes. But unfortunately, I don't think that we have protected the media so much in the country. And this does not only go to the government. It goes to all of us. It starts with you and me who are in the media. That one, we need to protect ourselves. Wear your mask, sanitize your hands. But also, if we are working for an entity, we invite as well the heads of these institutions that we need to cater for the health of our workers, our employees, especially the media. But government also needs to play its role, because the media is part of the citizenry. We need to protect our people. They need to know this. The media needs to bring out the information that government wants to bring out. So we need to protect them. We need to raise awareness amidst them. We don't need to accuse them at a time when we need them.
As the media, you know, played any major role in dissemination of information that's concerned, you know, to COVID?
It has done that. I will say it has played its part. It has played its part, because I said earlier that if we never had the media during COVID-19, I bet that we'd be having millions and thousands and billions of deaths, just in the world, but in Uganda itself.
We're talking about access to information, and do you think government has, you know, given us all the information that we need to know about COVID as a country?
Absolutely not. Government has tried its part, but it feels like, to an ordinary citizen, it feels like government wants to give us what they want to give. How I wish that government gives information out based on the recognized international, regional, and national practices. There is no offense in giving us the truth about the pandemic. There is no problem about telling us thousands of people are dying. Instead, you'll be preparing us for the better than telling us we have only got 200 people test for the disease.
But the government has given us that information on a daily basis. Ministry of Health, they tell us the number of cases we have in the country, those that have died of COVID, and the recoveries. So what kind of information do you want government to give us?
Now, COVID-19 is about transparency and accountability as well. We have had procurements. Remember when COVID-19 came, it affected every sector of the country, most especially the government procurement regulator, in that we've had to go for emergency procurements. And because of emergency procurements, we somehow, not, I don't want to say disregarded, but we somehow leaned towards, it's emergency, we need to procure the mask, we need to do this, without following the normal processes. And this is not just Uganda. I'll give you an example of Nigeria, for example. They went into emergency procurements as well, and they have a government procurement portal which tracks procurements, and so does Uganda, which is still a very great thing, by the way. But then what Nigeria did, in, I just want to contrast and bring out what we need to do better. What Nigeria did was to pass out an instrument that, you know, there's COVID-19, procurements are urgent right now, so we're going to have emergency procurements. But let us not disregard the need for opening up the data. So what the government went ahead was to create, or rather to align the government procurement portal to have a section for public procurements under emergency. Yeah. So it was an obligation on all government entities that put up the information on emergency procurements, and that is what our government needs to do.
All right.
As well.
Briefly, you know, as we bring this to an end, Susan, of course, you, civil society, you've all know that the media, of course, plays a very big role in dissemination of information, but then most of them are underpaid. There's little pay. And this is the reason we are seeing fake news. We are seeing lots and lots of things, the media being compromised. And of course, when they're compromised, they're not to give us the kind of information that we want to get from them. As civil society, what have you done to ensure that journalists, of course, first of all, are fairly, you know, paid well, and their rights are protected?
Well, we have also had engagements with civil society and heads of media institutions. For example, there's a project we're running right now, but also the World Bank funded one that we ran in the past, in that we brought all the three actors in the same house. And we talked about these things. And we're talking about them right now as well, that, you know, we do not, we accuse the media for letting out, you know, fake news, as they call it, misinformation. But the pressure under which these people operate, it's how many stories do you have today, and that is your pay. Yeah, the economy is biting so hard, especially right now during COVID-19. It's very important that we all have, you know, economic rights are for all of us, and this is what touches even extents of, you know, payments, work environment for staff, and that is something that we need to improve. So for us, we shall keep talking about this, and our engagements with government institutions in charge of media houses has not ended. Even today, we really, really invite everyone to come and join us. We have a high-level dialogue, which is running both physically and online. But unfortunately, because we have to wear our masks and prevent COVID-19, attendance is limited to invite. But invite to online platforms is not limited. Come join us. We shall be having the head of Uganda Communications Commission joining us, and we shall be talking more about these things. And mark you, we are also joined by Twitter today, the head Sub-Saharan Africa Twitter, and we're talking about the media. Okay. How is Twitter ensuring that the media's rights are actually recognized? So it's really a great conversation today.
All right. Thank you very much, Susan. Of course, you heard it from her. We had Susan Juliet Agwang. She's the legal and research officer at the Africa Freedom of Information Center. Of course, we've been talking about the access to information. As a Ugandan, you have a right to access information. You know, only maybe for that confidential one where, you know, it touches the security of the country, maybe that can be, you know, confidential that you cannot access it. But it's your right to demand for certain information, accountability, use of public funds, so that, you know, you get to know how it is, because at the end of that is your money, you as a taxpayer. All right, Susan, thank you very much for joining us. Of course, keep it right here. We'll be, you know, coming back and be talking about churches with a special guest. See you in a bit.